Hello and welcome to Elevenses with Lisa. I am Lisa Louise Cooke. Today I'm going to show you how to plot the boundaries of a piece of land in Google Earth. And we're going to take U.S. government survey legal land descriptions found in lots of different sources, like the federal land patents, which we as genealogists use, and quickly and easily plot the boundaries in the free Google Earth Pro software. I will also show you a way to do it for property in Canada as well. And of course, all of these strategies come to you from my book, The Genealogist Google Toolbox, and there is a link in the video's description below for that. So let's jump right into it, because if you've got a legal land description, it could be super helpful to be able to take a look at these in Google Earth as well. So let me head over here. All right. So when you're plotting your land, we're going to be using the free Google Earth software. You can follow along in the show notes at genealogygems.com/elevenses, where I will have all the details there for you as well. And again, as I mentioned, all of this information comes out of my book. Now, first thing you need to do is download and update the free Google Earth software. And the thing about that is you may already have it on your computer. There are actually three different versions, and so this can get kind of confusing these days. So first of all, there's the free software, and that's what we're going to focus on today. But there's also Google Earth for the Chrome web browser, and that's the latest, newest thing to come out with Google Earth. But the problem is it doesn't have all the bells and whistles and capabilities to do the kinds of things that we use it for specifically in genealogy, but really anything that you're doing geographically, you're so much better off in the software. There's also an app. So yes, on your phone, on your iPad, your tablet, you're gonna have an app, but again, it's a stripped down version. So if you land on a website that looks like this, let's say you Googled for it, you wanna make sure that you click the Google Earth Pro on desktop. That's what you want to do. And this is a download that you're going to install to your computer. It's absolutely free. But as I mentioned, plotting legal land descriptions in Google Earth has a lot of advantages in the software program because you can see what the area looks like today. So particularly for those of us working with addresses from long ago, perhaps the homestead of our ancestor, we want to be able to see what that location is today. We also want to perhaps be able to convert a legal land description into the current street address. So if you're looking at an old land description and you want to be able to figure out what exactly is the address today, this is how you're going to be able to do it. I'm going to show you how. You can also have access to additional tools in Google Earth that you can use in conjunction with the boundaries that you're going to create. Things like historic maps and adding area photos and looking at other people's photos in the area and a wide range of data sets that provide an awful lot more information about the area. So all of that is available. And if you get into a lot of different projects, particularly in genealogy, I talk a lot about many different kinds of projects you can do in Google Earth. You got to get all access to all of that. And Google Earth is going to allow you to save and build a library of maps. So this may not be the only location that you're plotting. If you're doing this in Google Earth, then you can kind of build on that and really have one place to go to on your computer where you can get this information that you've been collecting. Now, if you do already have Google Earth, and perhaps many people do at some point, download it, you know, you kind of go and check and make sure your house is really still there, right? You pull up your own address. Well, check your desktop. What you're looking for specifically is to see if you have the most current version. And one of the telltale signs is that you're looking for the gray globe, not the blue globe. The blue globe icon would be the old version, and the newest version is gray. Now, once you've opened it up, whether you've downloaded it or you already had it, you want to go to the menu, and you can check the current version. So under Help, we're going to go to About Google Earth. And that is going to tell us the version. So this little box will pop up. The very first item on this box is the version of the program. And you can see it says 7.3.4.8. I have a link in the show notes where you can click and always see online what the current version is to make sure at any point that you watch this video that you've got the most current. As of today, this is the most current. Notice that it says Google Earth Pro. That gets a little confusing too. We're used to thinking of it as Google Earth. In the old days, before Google Earth Pro, there was this free version. And then there was a pro version, but you had to pay for it. It was about $400. These days, that previously subscription version or purchase version is available for free to everybody. So technically, it's called Google Earth Pro. We're just going to call it Google Earth all throughout this video, make it nice and easy. Okay, so what you can do is after you open it up, leave it running in the background on your computer, because we've got some other websites to take a look at to help us with this process of plotting your land description. So get your land description. Now, in genealogy, one of my favorite places to look for one would be a land patent that my ancestors once held. So you're going to want to get this information in front of you, whether it's on a website like the Bureau of Land Management, government land records, where you can go and search for people in your family tree who once purchased land or were granted land by the federal government. Those would be on there. This is one from my family tree, George Burkett, and this is way back in 1820. They have the actual land patents handwritten out, the original documents. They've got scans of those, but they also have the legal land descriptions. So what I'd like to do is go look this up on a browser tab and keep this open so that I can refer back and forth as I'm working with Google Earth. So after you run your search here at GLO, if you were trying to get some land from here, I've got one here for George Burkett. So here down below at the bottom on the GLO website is the land description. You can see it tells me it's in the state of Indiana, so IN. There's a meridian, township and range, aliquots, and section. Now, you might be working with a different land description from some other source. That's okay. Now, I've seen this kind of data, this kind of information written up at the top of an old plat map. You know, when they put the kind of lay the town out on paper and they're writing in the names of the owners and how many acres they have, you might have a modern day, current day legal land description, but it should have this kind of information: the meridian, the township and range, the aliquots section, tell you what county it's in. Okay, so this is what we're working with. And you can see here that, just as a side note, the date was August 24th of 1820 that George Burkett and James McGuire got this piece of property. Should be about 160 acres. It was a cash sale. So super interesting to be able to see this kind of information about your own family. Okay, so I've got this up in a browser tab on my computer. Now, if you were to scroll down, if you happen to be using a land description that comes from the Bureau of Land Management, you'll notice it's mapped. But here's the thing. There are disadvantages of using the mapping of this kind of land description on websites. First of all, you can't download this map, so we can't get a copy of it. We can't add customized data or details to it. And that's something that you might want to do. You're going to want to not only map it out, but you want to be able to say, what's the purpose of this? Who did this belong to? What are you trying to accomplish? You know, all your notes and source information, that kind of thing. You're going to want that on your image. You can't really do that on somebody else's website. And you can't easily use it in conjunction with other related mapping work. So chances are, if you're going to bother to pull up a land description and try to plot some property, you're trying to accomplish something bigger than that. There's something else that this is for. In your genealogy research, maybe you're trying to build a whole community. You're trying to figure out the transfer of the land over the generations. So this information, if it's sitting alone on their website, you have to keep going back to it. You have to keep you know, revisiting it, versus if you bring it into Google Earth, you can do so much more with it and you can build upon it. So that's the idea. And you can easily save it. If it's in Google Earth, you can't do that. You can't, I suppose you could screenshot this using a Snagit tool, and that's okay. But we're going to be able to do a lot more in Google Earth. Okay, so in another browser tab, you've got your legal land description. I want you to open a new tab, and we're going to go to earthpoint.us. Okay, so this website is a free website that does have some subscription features. Okay, so you'll see that at the top in the right-hand corner that you can sign up for an account. I would encourage you, go ahead and sign up for the free account, because you're going to be working through this site. We're going to just use one of the features today, and we'll explore this more on this channel in the months to come. But when you go here, you're going to find that sometimes you're going to click on a tool and it's going to say, oh, you need to subscribe. You need to pay for a subscription. Of course, you have to have an account to do that. So if that's a really important tool to you, you'll do that. If there's also some, now the one that we're going to use today, you don't even have to have an account. But there are other tools that are available for free, but you have to be signed in. Okay, so just bypass the headache, sign up for a free account, and you can use it. I've talked to the gentleman who put this site together. It's really terrific. He does so much work pulling all this information together for free for people. We are going to not worry that we see subscriptions on the home page, and we're going to look over here in the left-hand column, okay, under USA Utilities. And let's pause right there and just say, if you happen to be, I know we have lots of Canadian viewers, if you have property that you want to plot in Google Earth that's in Canada, hold tight, because one, you're going to see the process here. This is really important, just generally speaking. And then I am going to show you how you can do this for Canada. So don't worry that Earthpoint doesn't support Canadian mapping. We'll give you another website that can do that. And also, I'll just mention, I'm going to actually have a little special thing at the very end of this show to answer one of your most pressing questions. I'm just going to tease you out there, okay? So you have to hang on to the end of the show. Okay, under USA Utilities, we're going to click on, under Township and Range, Search by Description, because we have a legal land description. Again, we are at earthpoint.us. Now, that's going to bring us to this handy dandy nifty page. And this gives us a place to enter the data that we have in our legal land description. And notice it says a user account is not needed for this particular feature. Okay, so here you've got five different fields for information that it wants you to enter. You might not have the actual section number in your particular description. Don't worry about it. You enter what you do have. And the important thing here to remember as you're doing this is start with the state. Start at the top of the list and put in the first item. And then give it a moment to kind of load, to kind of acknowledge that you selected a state. And that actually will load new data into Principal Meridian. So now you're only going to be shown the Principal Meridian information for the state of Indiana. So we would then look at our description again and enter the Principal Meridian. That, give it a moment, it just takes a second. It'll load up, and now only the townships available in that meridian will load into the next field. You get what I'm saying here? So it's really important to let it load and do them in order so that you are for sure getting the options. If you have a legal land description and you're not seeing the range number or the section number, chances are you're probably not in the right meridian, right? So just go back and check your work, because it will give you the options for the things that are available for that location. Once we get that all put in, then we're going to click Fly To on Google Earth. Now, remember, we left Google Earth open and running on our computer. And it's important to note, you got to have a internet connection going on while this is happening. Certainly when you're on a website, you do. But anytime you're using Google Earth, you need to be connected to the internet. And frankly, you need a fairly decent internet connection. So if you find that the pictures aren't loading very well, or it's, you know, blurry, or it's not moving, there's something about the internet connection, chances are, that are slowing you down. So just kind of keep that in mind. So we're going to click Fly To on Google Earth. And what this will do is create a KML file. Okay, let's take a look at this. We're going to come down here. Let's do it in real time. Search by description. Okay, and now we're going to come up here using our legal land description, and we're going to select Indiana because that's the one that I'm using as my example here. Principal Meridian. Now notice it's loaded. Okay, there's a first and a second in Indiana. So we're going to select second, and then township. So all of these townships fall within the second principal meridian in Indiana. We're going to select 20 north. Now within 20 north, if you click range, we gave it a moment. Just, you see, I'm just giving it an extra second to load up. Now we've got 14 east. And finally, our section number. So once we've selected this, we're going to click that Fly To on Google Earth, and this will generate a KML file. This is going to be saved on your computer. Okay, so go ahead and set up a folder for the work, the project that you're working on. So you've got a place to save it, and you can see it down here in our bar at the bottom. So we can go back into our file manager and we can click and open that up. If you lose track of where you put it, you can always click it again, resave it. When you click on that file, look what it does. It opens it up, it loads it in the temporary places, and it flies you there. That's the magic of what Earthpoint can do for you. So this is really cool. It's brought us to the state of Indiana, to the township of Winchester. And it has plotted the township for us, as well as section 9, I think it was, on our list. And it's important to notice it's over here in your temporary places. And the reason when you click a file that it opens in Google Earth, it's able to do that because, one, Google Earth understands that when you click a KML, your computer, in fact, understands that the KML is supported by Google Earth, okay? And if for some reason it doesn't, it'll prompt you, what program do you want to open this in? And the first time you do it, you would tell it Google Earth. KMZ files as well. So KML is a keyhole markup language file, and a KMZ is a zipped version, which typically has a little more data in it. Both of those open up in Google Earth. Google Earth is going to put it in your temporary places because it doesn't know if you're just wanting to look at it one time or whether you really want to hold on to this file. So we definitely do. Here it is in our temporary places. Okay, so that's the KML. And it's important to know that Google Earth does not automatically save your work. Let's say that again. Google Earth does not auto-save. So it's really important for you to file this somewhere within this places panel. See this middle section here? This is your places panel. These are your files and folders that you're creating. I like to organize things in folders, and we're going to file this. We're going to drag and drop it somewhere within the My Places where we want to keep it. Okay? So notice that over here on the left, whatever is clicked, whatever has the blue bar, that's what's displayed on the map. So right now, we've selected that. And most importantly, the box is checked. That's what makes it visible on the map. So stuff can be in your places panel, but if the box isn't checked, it will not be visible on the screen. Okay? So sometimes we see a whole bunch of junk all over and it's clouding our way and getting in the way of the stuff that we're looking at. And in reality, it's just that we have too many things checked. Go back and uncheck stuff in your places panel or the layers panel, and leave on just what you want to look at. So right now we've got activated the file that came out of Earthpoint. We want to take a closer look at this file. On your screen, you'll notice that there's the orange box. What does that do? That is your township. And inside that box is a little orange ball. If you click the ball, you get more details about the township. So it'll tell you the total numbers of the township. In this case, its total acres is 23,402 acres within this township of Winchester. Latitude and longitude coordinates for the center of town. So notice here the centroid. If you were to type those numbers or copy those numbers and put them in the search box of Google Earth and just hit enter on your keyboard, it would fly you to the center of town because those are the actual latitude and longitude numbers for that. It'll also give you those same latitude and longitude coordinates for the corners of the township. So essentially, how did it draw the box? Well, it did it by knowing what the latitude and longitude was, and it figured that out based on that legal land description that you entered into Earthpoint. So lots of cool data there, a convenient link back to the Earthpoint website if you need it. Let's take a look at it's kind of a pink magenta color, and it's the box within the orange box. That's your section, okay? That's that we told it that it was section number 9. So when we click the ball in the center of that box, now we can see in our dialog box that section SN or S9. So it's section 9, and then it tells you the township and the range. So it's added that you're in section 9, and it's also telling you that there are 648 acres within section 9. You still have all your latitude and longitude coordinates. So some kind of cool data that when you click on the little ball in the middle of those things. Now, we're not done yet, right? Because which part of section 9 did George Burkett own? He didn't own the entire section. We have to go back to, in this case, the original land patent. That's where I got that description from. And even though there was data down below, Earthpoint didn't ask for all of it. It didn't ask for the aliquots, did it? But I want to show you how you can do this yourself. Okay, so the aliquots tells you the portion of section 9 that George and James owned. So it says it's the southeast quarter. Now, sometimes it'll say the southeast quarter of the northwest quarter, right? So that would be first the northwest quarter of the section 9, and then the southeast quarter of that quarter. Yeah, I know it gets a little complicated. In this case, George made it easy for us. He said it was just, it's 160 acres is one quarter of section 9. It's the southeast quarter. And if we go back, and particularly for GLO records, these government land office records, you can go back and verify this. Go look at the original patent. And if you click patent image, you see the tabs across. I said we're in patent details right now, what I'm showing you. If you click on patent image, you'll see the image itself. And here it is on the right. And it's handwritten in there, southeast quarter of section 9. Okay, so let's go back to Google Earth and show you how you can do this. We're going to plot those acres that George owns with the polygon tool. Now, this is in the toolbar across the top of Google Earth. And there's lots of different tools here. The polygon just kind of looks like a funny, you know, spaceship shape or something. It's a polygon. So it's the third button over from the left. It's right next to the place mark button. And when you click that, as you with any of these tools, you're going to get this dialog box that's going to pop up. So it's asking you, hey, tell me, what are we doing here? What are we making here? Okay, so we are going to enter a name for this polygon. The polygon is going to mark the actual 160 acres within section 9. Okay, so first of all, I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to title it George. Now, I misspelled it. Uh-oh. We can fix that in just a second. George Burkett's 160 acres. So I put that as the title. Now, in the big box at the bottom, that's the description box. That's a great place to put your source. Where'd you get this information? You can also make notes to yourself. You can add any kind of information that you want to be kind of contained as the metadata inside this polygon. So that box down below is the place you're going to do that. Now, don't close it, okay? Because normally, when you're using your mouse in Google Earth, you're seeing a pointer. However, you'll notice that when you move your mouse over the map, over section 9, you actually have kind of a square with some little crosshairs on it. That's your drawing tool. That's how we're going to make our polygon. So I'm going to click first in the center of the section, and then I'm going to come down and make one quarter. I'm going to map out one quarter. It's the southeast quarter of section 9. So just click once in each spot. Center, go down below the south, and it's nice because you know, you can, most of the time in these farmland areas, you can actually see the lines there, and it's pretty laid out nice as a grid pattern. So I'm going to click that. I'm going to go over to the far right corner, that southeast quarter, click that. I'm going to go up to the top corner where the arrow is, click that. Okay. And that will draw this nice polygon. So now we've really narrowed in on what the land is. And if I'd love to know what kind of land that you're plotting. What kind of legal land description are you working with? And put that in the comments in the live chat if you're here in the live chat show, or the comments down below. And if you get this all plotted out, let us know how that goes, okay? Okay, so we're not done yet, because it'd be nice to be able to customize that a little bit, and you can do that. So we're looking back in the dialog box. Now, we were originally kind of in the description tab. Click one tab over within the dialog box and you'll see style and color. So this gives us an opportunity to change it up, and it would be really nice to be able to see the square, but be able to see through the square, okay, and make it a little more transparent. And we can make it any color we want. We can outline it. So that's what we're doing here. I've selected red as the outline, and then you notice next to it is the width. So we can increase that, we can decrease that, so it really stands out and marks it. I left the line as opacity is 100%. However, with the area, the fill area, I want to do something a little different. So I've selected yellow and I've sent that to about 50%. So it's nice. I can see through it, but it's really clear to me that this is the area that we're working with. Next to the area, to the color, you'll notice there is a box for filled plus outlined. That's currently the mode we're in. If you decide later, oh, I really just want to get rid of that fill for now, I want to take a look at it, you don't have to delete anything. Just select only outline. So you can pick the way you want that to look. When you get that all set, then you can click OK, and your polygon will be set. Okay? So let's do it in real time. See what this looks like. So we're going to come up here to section 9. And notice these navigation tools. If you want to see it at a little different perspective, you can change that. So you're kind of looking straight down on the property, and those are in your upper right hand corner. So here we are in the places panel. Notice that when I uncheck the box, it disappears. When I check it, it appears. So it's really that simple. Come up here and we're going to click polygon. Now there's our dialog box. So we're going to type in a new title for the polygon. Type in here that it's George Burkett's 160 acres. And then you can see that the cursor is blinking in the box below. So that's where we can add source information, notes to ourselves, any other details about this that we want to do. Now click style and color. That's the next tab over. And there's actually many more things that you can do in this box, but I cover those in the book and in some of my premium videos. Okay, let's draw the polygon before we color it. We're going to click on the center because I'm doing the southeast corner. We're going to come over here to the eastern border, down to the southeastern corner, and click one more time. Notice the different type of cursor that we're working with. Wonderful. Now, we're still in cursor mode, so be careful what you're clicking on, because now we want to really click on the point itself. Once you touch the point, you can move it around. If you need to adjust it, no problem, but I've actually added a second point, didn't I? So we can click or tap the delete button on your keyboard. That will get rid of the one that you're currently on and you've selected if you need to change it. So it takes a little bit of practice, just a little bit, to get used to not over-clicking on the screen and adding too many extra data points and being able to click and select a data point if you need to delete it or move it. So now I'm going to pick colors, and you can pick any custom color that you want. So if there's anything fancy you want to do, I think pretty much you can add any color you want. You can give it the exact code for the color. And we can do the outline, and we can do the fill color. So here we'll do yellow. We can change that up in any way. We can make it to change the transparency, remember? But we were still in outline, so we had to go back and select filled outline. Whatever you last did in one of these polygons is going to be what the options are. So it kind of remembers what you did before, and that leaves you there and assumes you might want to do that again. So if you don't see it, just change it to filled and outline. Okay, we're going to change our border to red. We can even do custom colors. That's kind of neat. And you can add those. Click OK. I'm liking the way it looks. I might want my border a little bit thicker, so I'm going to come up here and make it up to a 4. And you can see how that changes it in real time on the screen. Okay, super. Let's zoom in here. Uh-oh, that's going to happen. Don't worry. Okay, so you can drag it back in place. You can also click delete. So make sure you're on the dot that you didn't want. You've, you know, touched it, selected it, and then click delete. Okay, and here it is. You can see the polygon. I had selected that, you know, I had the blue bar. I'd clicked on the Earthpoint file. So I've added my polygon to that file, which I like. I like that it's all combined together versus a bunch of different separate files, because this is one land description. So notice that it shows the shape, a polygon, it makes it yellow, so it stands out. Whatever you're creating on the Earth, on the Google Earth map, that's going to show up in your places panel. So again, I got the polygon inside of my plotted land description by clicking and selecting that Earthpoint KML file, so that whatever I did from that point forward was going to be tossed in there. Make sense? All right. So don't leave this in the temporary folder. You're not done yet, because if you close Google Earth, you're going to lose your work, and I don't want that to happen. So you're going to file it. You're going to select a place, whether I want to drop it into one of the folders I've already created. At the very top of the places, it says My Places, and there is a globe. Think of that as like when you look at your computer, it's like looking at the C drive. It's the very top of the drive. So you can drop it right on there, and it will be, in a sense, at the top of the hierarchy there. So I would recommend, when you're going to move it, what I do is I click the little arrow next to that file that has many different things in it to kind of close it up. And then I click on the white space next to it. If you click right on where it says Earthpoint Fly To, it's just going to do it again. So it's a hyperlink. You want to click it to select it just to the right of it in the white space. And then you can drag and drop it anywhere you want to within the places panel. So let's do that. Here, I want to close this up. And again, you can check, uncheck, and it's visible or not visible. That's probably the biggest question I get from people is, how come I can't see what I just did? It's the checking of the box. Okay. So there's our item. Doesn't matter if it's on when we're filing it, whether it's on or off, doesn't matter at all. And you can even turn off an individual item within a nested folder. So you can do that too. I'm going to close the entire folder. So now it's all one thing. I'm going to click and drag it and drop it right on top of My Places. I want it to be at the very top of My Places panel. We could put it anywhere we want in between folders, inside of folders, the top, the bottom, doesn't matter. You just don't want to leave it in your temporary folder because it won't be there. Okay? So, awesome. You've got it. We dropped it. The polygon is filed in your places panel. So the final thing to do is you need to save your work because it's not going to autosave for you. So you go to the main menu at the top, file, save my places. That's basically just saying, save all my work. Everything that you've done in the places panel, anything that you've updated, whatever, you want that all saved so that when you close Google Earth, the next time you open it, it's going to have everything that you did and you can keep working. Okay? Super important. In fact, I would say if you were doing a lot of different things, I'm saving probably every couple of minutes. You don't know if Google Earth might crash, your power is going to go out, something's going to happen, and you will lose all your work. And the first time you devote a lot of time to plotting out land descriptions and you lose it, it's going to be really sad. So don't be sad. Go to File, Save My Places. Okay. Now, you are probably going to want to rename this file because it just has that Earthpoint label, and that's not what we really want. I want to have more information for myself because they're all going to start looking the same. That's the problem. If you start plotting a lot of different things, they're all going to look the same. So you can rename a polygon. There's really two ways to do this. First thing, on a PC, you can do right-click on the polygon. So notice again, I'm not right-clicking on that hyperlinked Earth Point fly to. I'm right-clicking on the white space kind of next to it. That's how you're kind of selecting the item. I think on Mac, it's probably a command click, but you guys, you Mac users know how to do that. So to get a pop-up menu on my PC, I right-click on it, and we're going to go to rename. And then I can just type in the new name and press enter on my keyboard, and it will be updated. However, if you don't like the right-clicking thing, you can go up to your menu, and under Edit, there's Rename as well. So again, most important, it has to be selected. Notice it's blue in my Places panel that I have selected this polygon so that I can rename it. And that way, my work is really customized to my work and what I do. Are you liking this? I hope you're liking this. I hope you're excited about being able to plot some of your own land descriptions. If you do, would you give the video a thumbs up? That's awesome because that helps YouTube know to tell other people about this video, which we really appreciate that you do that. Thank you. All right. Now you're saying, well, okay, at least I renamed it, but actually I mistyped George's name. I want to add more information. How do I get this thing open again? When I'm clicking on the polygon, I can't do it because that polygon is set. Google Earth's not going to let you mess with it and move it around because you'll lose the value of it. So you have to go into the properties. And the way you do that is, again, by selecting it in the Places panel, click the arrow pointing at the polygon's globe icon. So you see that little arrow right there? That's showing you there's something nested inside of this, what is now becoming a KMZ. It's a file with many different files inside of it. This is going to open it, and it will show you the nested content. So you're going to be able to see the original overlay that you created with your legal land description. The township's folder is holding a lot of that data it was displaying for you. So that's important. Leave that there. And then we have the actual polygon that I created myself. And that's what I want to edit. So the first thing was to open the nested. And now I can go and I can click to select my polygon. So we need to tell Google Earth which item we're trying to open, select it in the white space or on the unlinked area. If there's text, if there's a lot of text, just click somewhere where you don't see a hyperlink, okay? And now you can right-click on that. And instead of going to rename, we're going to go to properties. And you guessed it, this can be done as well through the main menu. So you would just go up to edit and skip down the bottom and it will say properties. That's going to reopen the entire thing so that you can edit it, make any changes you want, and click OK. All right, so you've done great. You've plotted your land, but it would be really interesting, wouldn't it, to know, particularly if you're looking at a historic piece of land, an old piece of land that is no longer owned by that person, well, what's the current address of that property? And even though I'm working with a land description from way back in 1820, I can do this, and you can do it too. So notice down here, here's my land description. There is no information about what the current address is for this location. So I'm going to go to Street View, and I'm going to show you the address. So we're going to zoom in, grab the Street View guy. You need the blue line. If there isn't a blue line, you won't be able to do this. But drop him on the blue line right outside the house that you see there on the property. And here we go. You can still see my legal land description, my section line here through here. The arrows on the street, you can click those to drive down and back. You can click the screen and drag it and turn and look 360 degrees. If you really don't want to see that pink section line, uncheck the box, okay? Because we don't need that right now. We can drive forward, turn here. There's the house. I think there were two houses on this property. Well, that would make sense, George and James, right? So let's uncheck that so we don't have to have that pink line going through the middle of it. But look, staying outside of this house in the upper right-hand corner, it says we're at 635 East, 225th North in Winchester, Indiana. So that easy. When you're in Street View at the location where you plotted your description, you'll be able to see the current day address in that upper right-hand corner. And also, an easy way to navigate is to use your arrow keys on your keyboard. So we can get out of Street View. We can exit Street View, and that's going to pull us back up to Satellite View. Let's go back and down to Street View and take a look at the other house and see what's here. Awesome. There's an old house, the barn, and in the upper right-hand corner, right next to where it says Exit Street View, I've got myself this current street address for that location as well. So it's really easy to do. And I hope you have fun with that, but I've got more to show you. As you're doing this, you know, you can take screenshots when you're in Google Earth, and you might say, well, I'd like to have pictures of that. But we've been using Snagit here at Genealogy Gems channel. And I tell you, it's unlimited what this tool is I'm using it for now. It's, you know, thank goodness for you guys watching this show, because it keeps pushing me to learn new things. And I'm finding myself just going, my world's exploding how I'm being able to use this tool. So it's a screen capture tool. And even though I could save a single image in Google Earth, I can actually do more when I use these in conjunction with each other. I'm using their templates. So I took a screen capture of Township 20 North, and then I zoomed in. I took another quick screen capture of Section 9. I went into Street View, and I used my screen capture tool to grab that by holding down my control key and just selecting each of those in Snagit. I could drop them into this template, and I customized this, add some source citation information. I can give it a title, and I love it puts the date at the bottom when I made this. I did this in like, I don't know, 60 seconds. So I did it really quick, but you can do this too. It's a really cool way to capture and document. So whether I want to just share this, put this in a book that I'm writing, or whether I want to show step-by-step process because I'm having trouble and I want to show it to somebody else and have them be able to see my work, Snagit helps me do that. If you want to learn more about using that, the tool, go and watch episode 61, which will get you started if you're new to that. Episode 66 gives you a lot of advanced features. For both episodes, check out the show notes. They're step-by-step, and there is a discount code. I checked today. It is still available today. It's Genealogy15, and that actually gets you 15% off, which is rare with Snagit. So think about, I know many of you have gotten the Snagit tool since we did those videos, and how fun to be able to use that in conjunction with what we're doing here. Now, before I show you how to do this for Canada, I want to show you where the show notes are, because I get that question a lot. I've put all this in writing for you guys. So over at my website, genealogygems.com, click Elevenses in the menu. Scroll down, you'll see the free shows, and then you'll see the premium shows. Here is plotting land for Google Earth. that's today's episode. If we scroll down below, there is another. For those of you who are premium members, I wanted to draw your attention. Ways to use Google Earth for Genealogy is episode 12. That is part of now the exclusive archive. And so you'll need to log into your premium account. Go check out that. We do a lot of other different kinds of projects. You can just see the power of what Google Earth can do for you. And be sure and go down to the resources section for those show notes, because like all of these episodes, we have that ad-free kind of step-by-step cheat sheet that you can download. So everything is here for you. We have ads on our site because it just helps keep the lights on and we can keep providing free content. But down here in resources is where you can download a premium member show notes. So that's a really nice PDF that you can search. And this is what it looks like. And they're usually like, I think today's episode, the PDF is about 6 pages and it is absolutely all step-by-step. You can save that to your computer. Also, if you want to learn more about Google Earth and you are a premium member, go to premium videos. And I want to show you there's a geographic tile. There's a whole section of these are the classes that I teach when I'm traveling around and doing webinars and conferences. So if you click geography, you're going to find several different full length videos just like this. There are 1 hour sessions typically. Very step-by-step. Every single one of them has a handout. So these have never been on the YouTube channel. These are the ones that I teach when I teach at conferences. So you can kind of, if you remember, you're kind of getting the on-demand all year long conference. And the one I would really draw your attention to is create historic map collections. Okay? Because remember how I made the folders and I was, there is so much that you can do to set this up. So it is perfect for genealogy and you're going to have tons of free historic old maps. Many of these are included in Google Earth. Many of them are kind of hidden in Google Earth. And then we go into David Rumsey and bring some in there. And I show you some other places where you can get them. Most importantly, I show them how you can show you how you can pull them together in Google Earth so they're always available for your research. So you can learn more about premium membership if you're not one at genealogygems.com. All right, before my little teaser, my special answer to one of your very special questions in a previous episode, I'm going to show you Canadian land. So Bill's great-grandfather lived in Regina. So I pulled up the 1926 Canada census and under place of abode, I noticed section, township, range, and meridian. Yes, sweet. Oh my gosh, we don't get this in the U.S. So down here is Harry Cooke living with his wife, Martha. I would love to know if you have Canadian ancestors. Put that in the comments and tell us where they are in Canada. And if you have looked up the land descriptions in the census. So I pulled this up. Now I downloaded this document, but here's another legal land description, but Earthpoint doesn't support this. So how do we do this? You go to legallandconverter.com. This is a free website. It can help you find land in Western Canada, British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, subdivided by the Dominion Land Survey, the DLS, and the Alberta Township System. I don't know what all that means, but all I know is it will plot Canadian land for you. And you can see at the top under legal land description to latitude and longitude, here we've got those same drop-down menus, much like Earthpoint, where you can enter your data. It's so awesome. So we need to go back, look at our legal land description, and I've put each one of these, and again, do them in order, and set these up. When you've got each one of them plugged in, click the calc button, and that's going to give you this page, okay? So there's lots of data here. Again, we've got those latitude and longitude coordinates and all that. What you're looking for, my friends, is the KML link. Okay, so do you see where I put the snippet from the Snagit clipping from the census? Look just above it under download corners, and KML is a linked file that you can click on. It's actually showing us here on the map where this is in Regina, but we're going to click KML because we know that Google Earth can read a KML file. So click the KML file to save it to your computer. Click the file to open it in Google Earth Pro, which your computer should automatically do. It knows that's what it is. You'll fly straight to the property and you can go check out Street View. Pretty fun. So let's do it. Let's click the KML file. There's the file. I'm saving it to my computer. Once I've got it saved, when I click on that file, here it is in my file manager. It automatically opens up Google Earth. I've got that open in the background. And there we are. It's so amazing. I love flying in, don't you? All right, Street View. Let's go into Street View. I know, I'm a geographic dork. I love this stuff. It's so much fun. I hope you guys are having fun. Okay, so, and here it is. I mean, things have changed a lot, but I like knowing where it is. So that's what Legal Land Converter can do for you. Again, if I want to rename this file because it's not very helpful, I'm going to right-click on it and do Properties. Just open the whole thing up. I could do just Rename, but I'd like to rename it and maybe put some source information in the description box. So you can make these changes, then click OK. And then we need to get that into a different spot. So I'm going to drag it and drop it in my historic map collection. Now I need to do my file save my places so that everything is saved before I close up. And now I can go back and I'm going to title it 1926 Canadian Residence for Harry Cooke. You can even click that place mark and change that up, make it a house, whatever. So it's very cool. And let's put it under Cooke. Might as well have it along with all my other Cooke files. And remember, file, save my places. Okay. And here's Street View. Again, click the Street View guy. You always find him in the upper right-hand corner of your screen on Google Earth. And you can jump right down. And it should tell you, I mean, it would look like we're on a highway here. So it may just tell us the highway name. If it's outside of a home, it's going to have a street address. So that is plotting the land with Google Earth Pro. This is episode 67. Got to get to the show notes for this because there's lots of great stuff here for you. Genealogygems.com/Elevenses. Now I'm going to head back here and see you guys. I'm sure you've been busy and people have been talking about, oh, they have ancestors in Canada and everything. I am going to comb through the show notes afterward and see what kind of question, or not the show notes, the chat, to see what kind of questions that you have and what I can answer for you. But I promised you, and this has nothing to do with land, I promised you the answer to the question. Somebody said, oh my gosh, okay, can you do this in Germany? I have not looked, Carolyn, to see if there is the German equivalent of this, but if I were you, I'd go to Google and I would type in Germany land converter, legal land description converter, and let's see what comes up. Wouldn't that be fun? Is there any way to do something similar with meets and bounds? That, Steve, is the number one question I get every single time. Hi, good to see you. No. Right now, no. And because you know as well as I do that there are so many little details like turn left at the stream and look for the tree with the three branches. I mean, you know, things have changed so much. Meets and bounds takes a lot of creativity, a lot of different sources to pull information together to try to find your way around. However, I think if I were going to look anywhere, I'd look in Google Earth for some of those landmarks. So I still think you can use Google Earth to your advantage with meets and bounds, but you're not going to have that same, you know, one-stop shopping web converter, unfortunately. I'm sorry about that. All right. And Jeannie says, this is amazing. Awesome. I'm so glad you like it. Okay, so I've gotten this question several times, and I know the men watching are like, oh. Okay, I got the question. Lisa, how did you curl your hair? And I used to have really, really straight hair, but I have been curling it. I've been doing some pin curls, but I wanted to show you the secret behind the curled hair.
What's happening? What's George doing?
He's doing my hair. Everybody keeps asking me how I do the pin curls. That's good. He's pulling them out. He's not putting them in, he's pulling them out. Come here, you. It's never boring at the cookhouse. Now you know my secrets. All right. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you had fun. Please tell your friends about this show. If they like genealogy, if they like land patents, whatever, tell them that we're here. We'd love to help everybody else climb their family tree as best as possible. And if you haven't already, click the subscribe button, because that sticks us in your library here at YouTube, which makes it super easy. It's like a favorite section, and you can always find the Genealogy Gems channel. Thank you so much for watching, my friend. I'll talk to you soon.